Look at these images I created just a few days ago with the new D5 render version 2.5. And not only were these images super easy and fast to create, but they also have a ton of amazing detail in them, which is really exciting. So let me show you how we created this scene. Now, before we start, if you want to download D5, I have a link down in the description below for a free trial and also a link to this model if you want to follow along. But to start, we're going to be using a SketchUp model I created. But just so you know, if you're using any other type of software that does modeling, anything I say in this video is going to work exactly the same. I'm just using SketchUp. Now, the first thing you're gonna wanna do once you have your SketchUp model and your D5 render is downloaded, you wanna get the new D5 render software known as LiveSync. You can download this right from their website, and what it does is it allows you to simultaneously interact with SketchUp and make changes that will instantly apply to both your SketchUp model and your rendering. Now, I'm fortunate enough to have a 2-monitor setup, but if you don't, just split up the screen on both sides so then you can still work live in both that SketchUp model and in the D5 render software. But once you have it downloaded, you should have some new buttons on the action bar in SketchUp, and simply just hit the connect to D5 render button and that live sync will start for you. Now, what I like to do before I actually start to add in those materials and the planting into my rendering software is I like to run through a simple checklist. First, you wanna make sure that you have most of your model done and the general feel done. This is just because as that render file grows, it can bog down your computer and it sometimes has trouble if you're making big changes while still using live sync at the same time. So assuming you have 75% of that model done, the other big thing you wanna make sure you have allocated is your colors or temporary materials to the things that you wanna manipulate. What this just does is it separates out those materials for you so that when you go ahead and change them in that render software, you won't end up with everything looking like one material because you forgot to switch them all. This can be done however you like. Some people like to do it by using colors so it's very contrasty in the model, or you could pick something that's very close to representing that material you want so that when you're in the rendering software, you remember what it is you wanted to make that change to be. After that, you're ready to bring your story and scene to life. So of course, as a landscape architect, the first thing we're gonna wanna focus on is planting. Now, my process for rendering with planting is always starting with the ground plane first. I wanna get this right pretty early on so that the feel on the ground is pretty close to what I'm envisioning, so that when I start to add in the rest of that planting, the image will start to make more sense and feel more accurate. So the first thing you need to do is select the ground and change it to a grass or a soil. Now you notice if you click on things, it's going to outline it in black, and that's how you're gonna be able to tell what you have selected and what you're going to be changing. Now for this grass, you can either change it directly in that inspector tab, which is going to be on the right hand side of your screen, and select grass, or you can choose from the asset library and then apply it to that texture. And a quick aside, the assets can be found by clicking on that asset buttons, which is on the top left corner of your screen. And remember, for all of these assets, keep in mind that you can always change it at any time. So don't get caught up in it now. Everything is going to come together at the end. So just start to apply things generally now. Now from here, we have a general backdrop plane. So I'll start to paint on my 3D grass now to give some life and some randomness to that woodland retreat. So I'll first create this on a new layer so that this can all go on that one layer. This is an important step not to overlook because as that model develops, if you don't happen to have a strong computer, it could become very slow and slow down your modeling process. So it's just a great idea to create a lot of these things on different layers for different things so that you can turn them off and you can keep modeling as you go and only turn them on at the end when you're ready to export that render. But to add in that grass, you want to head on over to the model tab within that asset library folder and you'll see a nature tab. A quick note here is that you can see there are literally thousands of assets, which is incredible and awesome to have that much variability and design options within a software, but it definitely can be overwhelming. So just don't forget that there is a favorites option. So add some of these assets to your favorites library as you're going. It's just going to make it a lot easier down the road for you when you need to find these. And especially if you're rendering a lot, it's good to just have some items that you know you like to use in your arsenal. Here I'm going to be using a grass cluster from an ornamental grass tab, and I'll be using the brush tool within the placement options to paint on my 3D grass surface onto my model. So to do that, you want to click the brush icon at the bottom left of the asset library, or you can press B on the keyboard and select the item that you want, and then you can paint on your surface. And keep in mind, there's a lot of nice little settings in here to check out. You can change the brush size, you can change the density of the object, the size of the object, the randomness of the object, and if the objects will snap onto that surface. So if you are doing something that has landform involved, you want to make sure if you're painting anything, you want to have the align to terrain option checked so that you're not having things floating in space. So now I'll just simply start to paint on that surface, and then I'll go back and erase some of the areas where I don't want to have that texture. And you can do this super fast, super easily with this eraser tool. And the eraser tool built in is really great. It's going to allow you to only erase the thing that you have selected. So in my case, I have three grass clusters on, so it's going to only erase those. Now, of course, at the moment, this is the only thing I have in the model right now, but if I had other things on and used this eraser tool and brushed over them with the erase setting, it wouldn't erase them, which is really awesome to have. Now, after I've gotten this to a place I generally like, I added another layer on that ground plane using some fern to just help bring some more randomness and variety to this natural untouched landscape. A quick note about landscape architecture rendering is, in general, you want to try to provide a lot of variety and change in your vegetation, because this is what makes that model look more realistic and accurate to the eye. Because you would just never see out in the wild 20 of the exact same grass or shrub or tree. Regardless of species, they all have this uniqueness to them. So you want to try to emulate that in your renders as much as possible. But the next thing I like to do after that ground plane is pretty close to what I like. I'll add in the background context to start to create my backdrop so the image just doesn't feel like it's floating in space. Now, within the asset library, there's a landscape tab and it has background planes in them, which has some great bulk foliage to add into your backdrop. So I just use those to give myself kind of an endpoint to that model. And you'll notice when you import a singular asset, you'll see some direction arrows and other toggles on that specific asset. And that's going to be how you'll rotate them, skew them, and move them around about your model. But once that was in, I decided to go back into the ground plane again and add in just some grasses and some shrubs in the background, just to kind of continually giving more context to that landscape and, of course, further develop that frame we're going for. But now the next step is the most fun part, which is to add in those trees. And for trees, again, the most important thing you want to think about here is the form and the size variability of those trees. While D5 has an incredible amount of species to choose from, you really want to make sure that you are choosing a good range of trees that are going to be accurate to the area so that it feels natural. So for me, since I'm creating this kind of woodland northern landscape, I'm going to be using a primarily oak maple dominant forest. So that's going to be what I'm going to use to create this backdrop. And I'm also going to be going for more of a fall landscape here. So I'm using different colored trees to help illuminate the story, but it's definitely not necessary, and just use it sparingly depending on what kind of vibe you're going for in your render. And what I think the best way to do planting is with trees and just more vegetation is to work from back to front. And with each tree selected, I'll kind of just sporadically and randomly place them throughout that backdrop. And with each layer of different tree, I'll keep doing that and repeat the process, and it'll create this really natural looking random landscape that's very typical to what you would see if you were out in a woodland landscape. Now, of course, this is landscape architecture, and not all planting you do is purely backdrop and planting. So for those specific trees and those focal points, I'll take my time and specifically put them in specific spots, make sure the size is appropriate, make sure the rotation is where I want it, and all those specific things. But for this case, it's more of just a general setting within this natural landscape, so there isn't too many focal point trees. But it's a good idea if you do have that focal point tree, you want to make sure that it's a very high quality tree and looks really, really nice, because it's going to be eye capturing, and you want to make sure there's a lot of detail in some of those up close and personal focal point planting. But as you can see, this landscape is starting to really feel alive and starting to feel like a real place. So let's take a break from landscape and let's work on our materials. Now, choosing materials is super straightforward. You basically just kind of search the asset library for what you want, and you just select it and paint it onto that surface you want to manipulate. Especially, of course, if you set up that file correctly in SketchUp, it's just gonna make it super easy to integrate these materials. And you'll notice as you're picking out materials and selecting them, your inspector tab is going to reflect what you just applied, and it's gonna have a bunch of options to manipulate with them. And these options, you can change pretty much everything from the color to reflectiveness, the scale, and more. I generally don't really tweak much of these right now. I usually just kind of make sure the orientation is right and the feel is right. And then once I do some of the test renders, if there's something that doesn't look quite right or I want to tweak something, I'll do that then. And as for materials, D5 again has an incredible library to choose from. So I really don't think you'll have a problem finding whatever it is you need to apply and look for material wise. Now after this, the last thing I usually do is I'll add in any details in the scene that aren't in SketchUp or just additional things that I think the render and scene needs. This could be people, objects, cars, and any effects that you want your scene to help bring that vibe and story out. So for me, it was just about adding character and storyline to this scene. So I added, a car, I added a woodshed, a bike, and just, a fire pit with some smoke, just to kind of give a sense that there's some activity and there's some story behind what's going on here in the scene. But since this is kind of a woodland retreat, there's not a ton of action going on in the shot, so I feel pretty good with where this is at. So let's move into the final part, which is the actual exportation and rendering process that D5 will do. So to do this in the most simple way is, of course, you could just select the image button on the top right, choose some settings and export, but I think some things you should look at before you get there are as follows. One is to head on over to the camera tab, which is going to be on your top right. And you want to change from a perspective view to a two-point perspective. To me, having a two-point perspective for some of those lower shots is going to really help make those lines look a lot cleaner and a lot straighter, which is much more natural to the common eye. And the other thing you want to set is the focal length. For landscape and just generally what looks natural to the eye is somewhere between 24 and 35 millimeters. Then from here, I highly suggest checking out D5 presets. They are honestly some of the best presets I've seen out of the few softwares that I typically use. They have tons of different ones to choose from, and I think the preset will get you really close to what you want, and then you can just slightly tweak to do your final renders from. To find these, you just have to hit the studio button, which is a little blue icon next to that asset tab to see the curated tab. So after that, I'll usually just kind of find the one that I want that I think fits the vibe of what I'm going for. And then I will make a couple other changes after that, but it's really just kind of maybe swapping out the sky, changing the brightness and shadows a little bit, maybe manipulating the color temp, the sun direction, and then the height of that sun. But everything else I don't play around with too much. Maybe we'll add some fog, but it really just kind of depends on that specific render and scene on what I'm trying to do. But in general, this gets you 90% of the way there, I would think, just with this preset. Then from there, you just kind of have to choose your aspect ratio, the file of the size, and the type of file, and then you can export it. And of course, for those of you who like post-processing in Photoshop or however else you like to post-process, you can select all of those channels and export them as well from here too. But yeah, this is how I created the scene. So be sure to check out D5. I think it's a really awesome rendering software. And it's also one of the most affordable options for high quality renders. And it's also one of the easiest ones that I've used too. So again, if you want to try out D5 Render, I do have a free trial in the link below. And there's also a discount there if you want to use that pro version. And also the link for the SketchUp model and for the D5 file will be down below as well if you want to follow along with the process, or you just want to hop around in my render and see some of my settings and some of the trees and assets that I've used to create this scene. But anyways, that's going to be all for me today. So I hope you enjoyed the video. If you did enjoy the video, be sure to give this video a thumbs up. I'd really appreciate it. And also just comment below and let me know what you think about this new software. I'm gonna be doing a whole new series on landscape architectural visualization that's gonna be coming out for the next couple months. So I'm really excited about it. So stay tuned to see when those all come out. Alrighty, take care and I'll see you in the next video. Peace.